How many cases of honor killing have you heard of? Do you know how many men and women are killed because of honor killing? It is so infamous that Bollywood has made several movies on this social stigma. Popular storyline generally follows two people who want to get married and from a different caste. But not only this, a lot of you might remember the Hathras Con, where the parents were even denied the basic right of cremating the daughter. Most of you would not be surprised to know that in rural India, there are different neighborhoods for different castes. A Shudra cannot go past a Brahmin's neighborhood or a Kshatriya's neighborhood unless they have some work on their working day. But has this always been the case? What if I tell you a Brahmin can be a Shudra and a Shudra can be a Brahmin? Would you believe me? Maybe not. For the last 200 years, casteism has become a very stringent norm of the Indian society. So much that it has become a factor of our identity. But what do we really know about this system? For generations, it has only fueled discrimination and tragically cost lives. But how did all this start? Can this be blamed on the Vedas? Or is Manusmriti the sole reason for this divide in the society? Do Islamic invasions have anything to do with this? Or it is just another colonial hangover that we are not able to get past? Today, we'll not only answer these questions, but dig deep into the pages of history to find its origin. Hi guys, my name is Harry and welcome to another thought-provoking video. Please do let me know in the comments what are your thoughts on the casteism or if you have any experience that you would like to share. So before we start with the video, first let's understand the origin of the word caste. Caste is a Portuguese word which is derived from the word casta, which means origin or lineage or race. So when Portuguese arrived in India on the western coast, they were not able to understand the complex system of their Indian society. So to their incomprehensible primitive brains, this looked like a division in the society like they had for black and whites, and they had slaves as well, but we didn't. So they thought that we are also working on the same kind of society where there are different divisions. But just hold on to this information. I know that the word has a colonial origin. We would use this information for a later part in this video. For now, let's start with the history. We have been taught in history books that the origin of caste system goes back to the Vedic civilization, which dates around 1500 BC. But is that accurate? Because in Veda, there is a system which is called Varna system. And today, we relate the Varna system to the caste system which is there in India. In our history books, we have been told that Varna system is actually the caste system that we have in the modern India. But is it really true? To answer this, first we need to understand what exactly is a Varna. Varna system, which is mentioned in Vedas, had four divisions in the society. So the first one is Brahmins, who stand at the top of the ladder. Then we have Kshatriyas, followed by Vaishyas, and at the bottom, it is Shudras. But this is actually incorrect. There was no classification. These were the jobs that the people used to do. And I'll explain each and every job that they had. So Shudras were responsible for all the laborious work. For example, a blacksmith is a Shudra. A farmer is a Shudra. A carpenter is a Shudra. So any skill that involved labor were Shudras. And Vaishyas were the accountants who were responsible for all the trade and commerce of that particular kingdom. This included all the merchants, all the shopkeepers, or even the munshis that we popularly know as. So Vaishyas were responsible for the economy of a kingdom. Kshatriyas were responsible for defending the kingdom. They were the ones who used to bear arms or be the rulers or who were responsible for taking fights, expanding the kingdom and defending the kingdom. Similarly, Brahmins were the scholars. Brahmin is actually a very vast occupation that has been described in Vedas. Brahmins would include philosophers, researchers, or courtiers who would offer their assistance to the king. So the person who needs to become a Brahmin need to have expertise in a lot of things, or at least be a master in one. So these were the occupations. And in Vedas, it is defined beautifully that how it would represent, and to make it easy for you to understand, I would also use the same logic and same theory. So they say that Brahmins are the head, Kshatriyas are the arms, Vaishya are the stomach, and Shudras are the legs. Now, if I ask you in your human body, which part is more important? Your legs, your hands, your stomach, or your brain? I bet each and every part has its own role. And that's what Varna system in Vedas is defined as. They've also explained that why each and every part of this system is important for a society to run. Imagine a society without farmer. Imagine a society without blacksmith. Imagine a society without an architect or without a carpenter. Would you be able to live? No, you would be the nomads who would just roam around. So here is where the settlement started and where each and every part was given its own importance. I hope this clarifies that what exactly is the Varna system. Now let's talk about how this system was decided. I said at the beginning of the video that a Brahmin can become a Shudra and a Shudra can become a Brahmin. But how did they decide that what Varna you belong to? Well, for this, there was an organized system that actually continued till 1820. And that system was called the Gurukul system. And let me explain how the Gurukul system worked. So in Gurukul system, a pupil who was interested in learning would reside at the guru's place. And there they were given equal opportunities, same education, be it son of a Brahmin, Kshatriya, Shudra or Vaishya. Everyone lived together and learned the same skills. The person who excelled in philosophy, in brainstorming, in research, the one who was a thinker would become a Brahmin. The one who excelled in the art of war, the art of governance, would become a Kshatriya. The one who excelled in art of commerce would become a Vaishya. And the person who would excel in any of the laborious arts, like be it a tailor, carpenter, blacksmith, goldsmith, they would become a Shudra. But again, the important thing is, it was not that Shudra is at the bottom and Brahmin is at the top. These were just the occupations. You can relate the system to today's world as well. If you work in a corporate or if you work in a government job, we have different designations. Like we have a peon, we have a supervisor, we have a worker, we have a manager, then we have senior manager, then we have upper management like CEO, vice president, so forth and so on. So these are not castes. These are your occupation, your designation. And this is what was there in Vedas. And that's why Vedas have said that every person is important for the society to run. Imagine in your company, if your management stops working, if your manager stops supervising you, what would happen to the company? The company would crash. Similarly, the society would crash. And this was not that you are forced to become something. You had a choice. For example, we have non-medical, medical, arts, commerce. That's a choice. No one forces you. Unless your school is very stringent that you need to have a 70% to take non-med and medical and so on. So yeah, there were limitations, but it was free of choice based on your excellence. Hence, a Brahmin can become a Shudra and a Shudra can become a Kshatriya. And you would say that, Harry, but where exactly is this written? Well, it is written in a lot of Indian scriptures. And here are some of the examples for you. You must have heard of Vishwamitra. He was guru to Lord Ram, but his son was in fact a Shudra just because of his skill set. Vidur, who was a courtier in Kaurava's court, was born a Shudra. Atre Rishi, who is known as one of the greatest sages in Indian scriptures, was born as a Shudra and a son of a criminal. Kavash Rishi was son of a Shudra. Kalidasa, the latest example that I can quote, was born into a Shudra family. So now the question arises, who is a Shudra? Everyone is a Shudra, is the answer. Because everyone is born without any education, without any skill set. And the moment you learn, the moment you grow, that's when you become a Vaishya, a Kshatriya, or a Brahmin. So yes, it is not a stringent system. Vedas were written somewhere around 6000 BCE to 1500 BCE. The dates are speculative, but 1500 BCE is a widely accepted date. So you might say that that's too old, man. 3500 years ago, the society has changed, everyone evolves, and that's how the Varna system evolved into caste system. Well, let's look at some of the later examples. Chandragupta Maurya, the founder of the Mauryan Empire, is said to have been a Shudra according to the Puranas, who, because of his karma and because of the guidance under his guru Chanakya, became a Kshatriya and then became a king. And since then, Mauryans are known as Kshatriyas. So during his court in around 300 BCE, Megasthenes was a traveler who came to Chandragupta. And do you know what he has documented about the Indian society at that time? In his book, Indica, which is written by Megasthenes about his visits in India, he mentions that Indian society was divided into seven parameters, not four, seven. And this is something that he says and not something that I am saying. These were the occupations. These were not caste, these were not varna, these were not jati, the occupation. And this is something that you can find in his book. So 1200 years from the Vedic civilization, in Chandragupta's court, a traveler from another country is saying that these are the occupations in which this society works. And he is taking this as the learning to the Greek society so that they can improve on their system and actually match the Indian system. Because they thought this was the reason why India is the richest and why India is the strongest. So now this was something in 300 BC. Now let's travel 600 years to 3rd century CE and talk about Manusmriti. Manusmriti has been the most controversial book in Hindu scriptures and has been multiple times accused of being the birthplace of casteism. But how truthful is that? Is it really true? Or do we even know what Manusmriti is all about? Let's go ahead and clear the air from the Manusmriti. Manusmriti means a book for Manav. Manav means men. And it is not that it means males. It means it is for the humans. Because whenever we talk about the word Manav or Manu in Indian scriptures, it talks about the human race. It doesn't talk about specifically males. And what exactly the book is about? The book is all about laws by which a society should live in. The Manusmriti can be broadly categorized into 6 parts: laws and social order, the Varn system, dharma, social and family life, punishments, and spiritual and moral guidance. So Manusmriti had its own importance in the time of governance. However, we haven't seen a single proof where a particular kingdom or a particular king has established Manusmriti as their constitution. So Manusmriti is a vast book, and we can't really delve into all the chapters of Manusmriti. But about the caste system, I would show you 2 of the shlokas that you can see on your screen right now. The shloka says that a Shudra is a first birth, Vaishya, Brahmin, and Kshatriyas are a second birth. So does this mean that in your first birth, you are a Shudra, and you have to be born again to become a Vaishya, Kshatriya, or Brahmin? This is what was interpreted by Max Miller. We will talk about him in a while. But first, let me explain what exactly this means. It means that everyone is born a Shudra. Once you gain some education, that is your second birth. That's why it talks about the second birth being Vaishya, Kshatriya, or Brahmin, so that you have gained information and now you are progressing in the system. And it categorically says that everyone is born a Shudra. So this is one of the shlokas. Now the second shloka, which has been most controversial, and that a lot of people who haven't studied Manusmriti say that there are different punishments for different castes. Again, there is no caste in Manusmriti. And Shudras are treated more stringently compared to Brahmins, Vaishya, and Kshatriya. For this, we will quote another shloka for you. So let's see what this shloka has to say. It says, for a theft, a Shudra should be given an 8 times punishment of the crime. A Vaishya should be given 16 times punishment of a crime. A Kshatriya should be given 32 times punishment of a crime. And a Brahmin should be punished at least 64 to 128 times of the severity of the crime that they have committed. Is it being stricter for Shudra, or is it more stringent for Brahmins? I will explain the reason why as well. Why they have such a punishment in picture is because of the intellect level. I will give you an example. If in today's world, a governor of RBI commits a crime or a financial fraud, he is aware how the system works. He is aware where he can be scrutinized. So he is doing it deliberately. On the other hand, a person like me, who's not that familiar with the financial system or the taxation system, that could be called as a negligence. Similarly, a Brahmin is more educated, knows more about what is right and what is wrong in the society. So they are doing a deliberate crime. A Shudra, on the other hand, is not that educated. He might not be aware that he is actually doing a crime. So this is what it says in Manusmriti. So all the people who say that Manusmriti has stringent punishments for Shudra have definitely not read Manusmriti at all and are just following what Max Müller has written for us. And now let's talk about Max Müller. If you have not heard the name, then it's no surprise, because he was one of a missionary of Christianity who came to India with one mission, and that was to discredit Sanatan Dharma. He was the person who introduced Aryan invasion theory, which has been disproven multiple times by our Indian historians. And if you still have questions about it, I have a video linked here that you can click on debunking the Aryan invasion theory. Let's talk about Max Müller a bit. He was a German scholar who had a degree in philosophy in Sanskrit grammar. So he was a person who studied Sanskrit, but literal Sanskrit, grammatical Sanskrit. and I will explain how exactly a grammatical Sanskrit is different from the Vedic Sanskrit that we have. So that's what he did, and he went to England. He was looking for a job, and at that time, British East India Company had just faced the First War of Independence, the Spoil Mutiny, and they wanted to brainwash the Indian society so that it could be easier for them to govern us and that there is no other fight for independence. And maybe they succeeded in this. So what did they do with Max Müller? So Max Müller spent 10 years in India, translating the Indian scriptures in such a way that they look inferior to the Christianity. And then they can go ahead and start converting people to Christianity. So he spent 10 years of his life formulating theories like our invasion theory. So this is what Max Müller was. This was his job. So can we really trust the translation that he did? No, because today we have access to information. We have internet. We know English. At that time, we did not have those resources. So if you go ahead and take Max Müller's translation and keep it aside with a lot of Indian rishis and a lot of learned people who have translated the same shloka, you would see a stark difference. So that's why never take a translation to the face value unless you know that where exactly that translation is coming from. And now let's address the question that what is the difference between the Vedic Sanskrit and the grammatical Sanskrit that Max Müller was trained on. Now if we talk about Varna, what is the meaning of this word? I'll give you 10 seconds to search for it. So Varna means color, or it means alphabet in Devanagari, which was broadly translated in Vedas to classification because there are different colors. So there are different classes. So if you go for the literal meaning of Varna, you would say color. So Varna system would be color system, right? No, everyone was brown at that time. So how can this be a color system? It was a classification system. So these are the nitty-gritties that you need to understand by being in a culture rather than just being a grammatical scholar who knows the literal meaning. And that's what they utilize for their advantage. Enough about Max Müller. And we have already talked about Manusmriti. I've quoted two shlokas. So I have a job for you. Hit that like button right now, because as soon as we reach 100 likes, I will go ahead and bust a lot of myths on Manusmriti. We have 100 likes and I have another video for you. Even after knowing all this, there would be few people who would have question in their mind that in Mahabharata, there is a story of Eklavya, which actually addresses the issue of casteism. But what exactly is the story of Eklavya? Eklavya was a Shudra born who went to Dronacharya to learn the art of archery. And Dronacharya denied the request, stating that he only teaches Kshatriyas. But is that really true? What's exactly written in Mahabharata? The story goes like this. Eklavya goes to Dronacharya to learn for archery. But what Dronacharya says is that I am currently training Kshatriyas. I don't have enough time to devote to you. So I'm sorry, I won't be able to teach you. You need to understand, Dronacharya was hired to train Kauravas and Pandavas. So he had a job and occupation that he was dedicated to. Imagine yourself, if you're working for a company and third person comes to you and says, kindly help me with this project. Would you be able to do that? What matters is how much you're getting paid, right? Because today money is important, but at that time, the word of a person was important. That was the reason why Dronacharya denied the request. Now you would talk about Eklavya donating his thumb as a Guru Dakshina to Dronacharya. Why did that happen? Well, yes, there was a motive of Dronacharya behind this. But it was not because he's a Shudra. It was because Arjuna was his pupil. Arjuna was impressed by the archery of Eklavya. And he questioned Eklavya that who is your guru? And he said, Dronacharya. Arjuna was really devastated that how can he teach someone else? And it was ego of Arjuna that was speaking at that time. So we need to accept that. But it was not because Eklavya was a Shudra. So he went to Dronacharya that how can you take another pupil when you're hired to train us? Dronacharya was taken aback because he did not remember training anyone. So when he asked Eklavya that when did I teach you? He said that after you denied my request to be your pupil, I made a picture of you. And I used to practice archery in front of that picture. And I used to secretly listen to the lessons that you gave Kauravas and the Pandavas. That's how I gained the skill of archery. Now Dronacharya was in a position where he had to make a choice. If in case he was ready for another pupil to take over Arjuna. And that's why he asked for the thumb of Eklavya. So this is what the story is about. It is not about a Shudra being denied of the privilege of education. It is about a competition being eliminated for one of the pupil of the guru. I hope this would answer a lot of your questions about the casteism in Mahabharata and Ramayana. If you are still not convinced, do let me know in the comments. Now let's move to the 6th century AD. because Manusmriti was completed around 4th to 5th century AD. And why we should not blame Manusmriti is what I'm going to answer. So what exactly happened in Islamic invasions? Islam is a religion which is divided into multiple sects. If I remember correctly, there are more than 300 sects in Islam itself. And to your surprise, a lot of Arab countries consider Asian Muslims inferior to them. So Islam is divided into different sections. When they came to India, they realized that there is a division in the society, but that division is not between the people. And that's when they started manipulating the caste system. They hired few of the pandits for themselves. And they started again manipulating the Indian scriptures. They told the lower class that you are called as Shudras and you are at the bottom. You are the people who are the firstborn and they are the secondborn. And you should not stand the discrimination. Why should Brahmins hire you and why can't you hire a Brahmin? So this kind of stuff started going on when the pandits were hired by the invaders. And that's when the division in the society started. Now you might ask, where is the proof? There are a few questions that I would ask you before we address this question. The first question, has there been any proof in past before the Islamic invasions that there was a caste system or the society was divided? We have well documented proofs of Gupta Empire, what exactly happened during Gupta Empire. We have documentation of Aryabhat, Brahmagupta, the learned people. Have they ever expressed their ego that they're Brahmins? I bet you and I challenge you to get me even a single proof where discriminatory word or discrimination in the Indian society has been mentioned before the 6th century AD. But you might ask, there are no divisions in Islamic society as well, which have been documented. And I will say that you're wrong. We have proofs, a lot of Indian sages, which talk about the Jatiwad in or during the Islamic period. I would give you a brief history of a Bhakti movement. Bhakti movement was started somewhere around the 8th century CE, which is around the Islamic invasion or the Islam being established in India. And it lasted till 17th century. So a lot of Indian sages, renowned Indian sages, have talked about casteism. And I would list few of the dohas on the screen and you can go through. The first one is Kabir Das. Jati na poochhi sadh ki, pooch lijiye gyan. Mol karo talwar ki, pada rahe do myan. It says that don't ask someone's caste. Inquire about their wisdom. Value the sharpness of the sword and let the scabbard be. So what exactly this means is that wisdom is greater than your caste. And respect a person for their wisdom and not their caste. So we see that casteism is growing in India or it is being practiced somewhere. Or there is a division of caste. And similarly, you can read the Doha for Tulsidas. You can read the Doha for Mirabai. You can read the Doha for Ravidas. You can read the Doha of Namdev. They are talking about the caste system, but they are not talking about discrimination in the system. So even during the Islamic invasions, when it was starting, even till the 15th century, because a lot of these poets were there in the 15th century, they have not mentioned about discrimination. The first mention of discrimination that we see is by Guru Nanak Dev Ji. And I will explain what is written in the Guru Granth Sahib about the different varnas. So what Guru Nanak Dev Ji is saying is that now the people are divided into neighborhoods where a Brahmin is eating with a Brahmin, a Kshatriya is eating with a Kshatriya, a Vaishya is eating with a Vaishya, a Shudra is eating with a Shudra. They are only talking about groups. He has not talked about any discrimination or any challenges that people have in intercaste marriages. Why? He was one of the most blunt and one of the most bold poets of the 15th century. So if he has not mentioned it as a social evil, then was it really there? Now let's fast forward to the last guru, Guru Gobind Singh, the last Sikh guru who actually finished the compilation of the Guru Granth Sahib. At the time of the formation of Sikhi, when five people were offered Amrit and they became a Sikh who were independent of the society and whose job was to defend everyone in the society, be it Muslim, be it Hindu. They were Shudras and they were made warriors. And from that time, those clans became a Kshatriya. So here is another example of a change in the caste or of a change of an occupation of a person. Then what exactly went wrong? If even till Aurangzeb, we don't see any concrete proof of discrimination in the society, when did exactly all this start? Now it's time to look at the colonial period of India and British invasions. So after British invasion in India, they actually started conquering Indian territories slowly. In 1820, literacy rate of India was 100%. And British were struggling that how exactly they can discredit the Indian system. We have already talked about Max Müller, but Max Müller came later after the 1850s, after the First War of Independence. So what they decided is they need to discredit Indian education system. So they started demolishing gurukuls, a long tradition which was continuous for more than 20 centuries, was discontinued by British after 1820. But that was not enough. They needed more division in the Indian society. So they formed two things that would actually help them tackle the Indian society by dividing it. The first was a religion. Because no matter how strict Aurangzeb was, the harmony between Hindu, Muslim, and Sikh was unbreakable. They first started dividing us on the basis of religion. The second thing that they did was division of Indian society by casteism. The proof is the first census was done in Chennai, where they had to calculate how many people are Brahmin, how many are Kshatriyas, how many are Vaishyas, and how many are Shudras. This is where the first census happened. British made it mandatory to mention your caste on the government document because British knew that this is how the society would be divided. They started treating everyone based on their caste differently. Brahmins would be less taxed. Same for Kshatriyas, they would be taxed less. Shudras would be heavily taxed. Most of the Shudras used to work in the factories that British were establishing in India. This was the starting point of division in the society. And it is during the colonial era, we see a lot of discrimination being happening between the groups. Because this was slowly and steadily inculcated in our minds. We were brainwashed by the British education that how Hinduism is inferior to Christianity. It was engraved in our education system that India is divided by casteism. And that's what we have been continuously following. The division that we see in the society is no more than 200 years old. But what's the bad part? That we are still sticking on the way. Whatever translations the Britishers made was read and studied by scholars like Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Not only him, a lot of Indians, majority of Indian population, were influenced by the translation of Max Müller because no one was studying Sanskrit as the Gurukuls were abolished in the 1820s. So who is to be blamed for the casteism in India? I would leave it for you to decide. Is it the Vedic civilization? Is it the Manusmriti? Is it Islam? Or is it British invasion? Who exactly triggered the division in the society? Who is responsible for it? And why are we still following it? You go into a big college like AIIMS, you go in IIT, you will see different division of sections where people of different caste are living in a certain part of the hostel and where the OBCs or SCs, the people who are there by reservations, are living in different sections. Why? We are getting educated and the world system talks about education. Why are we still following it? Why a person of a different caste cannot go to a neighborhood of Brahmins or Kshatriyas? Why? And why you can't marry a person of your choice and you have to look for an approval of their caste? Why an MLA has that audacity to urinate on a person who is from a lower class? Incidents on discrimination and violence due to casteism are growing day by day. And this is something which has only happened in last 200 years. Who is to be blamed? And why can't we overcome the caste system? It is you, it is me, it is us who can actually make a change. Thank you for your time and do share your comments. This is Harry signing off. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.